You kick your ball, and it goes over the back wall, and then over the river, and then over the next town, and into a place where you never imagined it would ever end up. And that's the, I guess, the metaphor for this song. And there's, you know, there's 4/5 of you is going, oh my God, I can't believe I kicked my ball out that far. It's amazing. And I guess those 4/5 totally outweigh the one little part of you, the 1/5 of you that's going, I want my fucking ball back.
Just a little bit.
Thanks, Mar. You're brilliant.
Don't say that yet.
It's a great life we have, isn't it? Songbird from her cage. Never thought I was chivalrous, cunning or brave. I will build you somewhere you can stay, and I'll pray that you don't fly away. Fly.
A girl made that in America, didn't she? A girl made that in America. See, that's Glenn's hat. She made him a mer. She actually knit one of these for you and Mara, didn't she? And then knit just one for the Oscars, two Oscars.
Yeah.
And then we were saying, imagine if Mara and Glenn gets married and you'd say, me mad and that, I have an Oscar each. Imagine that. Imagine. Can you imagine that? No. It's so, it's unbelievable, like, imagine if I was able to say me mad and I have an Oscar each. Do you imagine that? But Jesus, when I heard his name got called in, oh my God. I mean, John Travolta is calling out his name.
And the Oscar goes to, excuse me, Glenn Hansard, Arcadia Globa, for Falling Slowly for Months.
We made this film 2 years ago. We shot it on 2 handy cams. It took us 3 weeks to make. We made it for 100 grand. We never thought we'd ever come into a room like this and be in front of you people.
No matter how far out your dreams are, it's possible. And, you know, fair play to those who dare to dream and don't give up. And this song was written from a perspective of hope, and hope at the end of the day connects us all, no matter how different we are. And so thank you so much who helped us along the way. Thank you.
We're in about 30 kilometers from the ocean.
Those mountains over there in the distance are in the north of Ireland.
I've been making music so long that that's what I do. Like, I left school at 13, I don't do anything else, you know. My ma said to me, all your eggs are in one basket, you better do it. And I was like, well, yeah. But in a way, I kind of feel that that gave me some sort of, you know, very clear direction, because I just really wanted to be a musician. I was really lucky. I had a great headmaster. The head teacher in my school was a DJ. And so I was in a lot of trouble in school. He said to me one day, he said, look, you can tell me who played bass on Neil Young's Harvest, or you can tell me the track listing of Bob Dylan's, you know, Street Legal Backwards, but you can't tell me the square root of 9. And so it's kind of, you're not much good to me. So here's what I suggest. And he was great. He gave me the best deal. He said, leave the school today. I'll make up some excuse, because you're not allowed to leave till you're 15. I'll make up some excuse, leave the school, go get your guitar, and today, go into the city and start playing. And in a year, come back to me. And if in a year you've really enjoyed it and you've gone off and you've done it and it's become your life, then great. If you haven't, I'll take you back to school. And I was so happy with that. So I did. I left school that day and I went home and I got my guitar and I said to my mother, look, I'm going to go busking. You know, I've left school. And she was like, what? You what? It was, you know, loved it. Absolutely loved it. And was completely on my path then. I think inside of us all there's some kind of wish to escape to a whole other life. You know, I've always been fascinated by this idea of fugue, which is a medical condition where you one day you just change your name, you move to another country, and you start a whole new life and you never refer to the past. And I'd always been fascinated with this idea, and I think that in a very small way it was kind of what I did. I just reinvented myself. The Urgles, the family, kind of became my other family, and I found myself kind of emotionally migrating to Czech.
I think I was 13 and I was in school, and like he didn't really have anywhere to live in Dublin at that time, so he would just kind of go visit us in Czech. And while he was writing songs in the house. You know, sometimes I'd come back from school and I'd see him there composing or whatever. So he'd play me his ideas and he'd then go, you know, do you want to try sing harmony or play something on the piano? So I would, and that's kind of how it started, like innocently, you know, just me playing piano or singing harmony on his demos.
Well, I may not hold you for as long as the heavens permit. I may not know you for as long as forever exists. There will be distance that we'll both have to come to expect. B, and the wild envy. Please don't do that to me. Of our B, C sharp minor. Of our dark and feathered friends. Stop. And we wait. You gotta sing with me. A mighty soul. B, that cuts through bone and lays the liars down.
Subconsciously, there was this thing in me, like, you know, one day maybe I'll be old enough to, you know, which is funny, because that's exactly how it happened. I did kind of, you know, at one point it became, I guess, okay, and nobody made the decision. It just, you know, our relationship got much intensified by what we were sharing together with the music and with the you know, the amount of time we were spending together, because up until then we never really saw each other. But yeah, I fell in love with him instantly, you know. It's kind of mad, but it's true. It's true.
You ready?
No!
Oh, I'm not doing it alone.
I
won't do it alone.
Okay, come on.
Ready?
Yeah.
1, 2, 3. Yeah? No one's gonna get offended around, are they?
No. Go on. I remember he kind of had the verse idea. He was singing the, you know, I don't know you, but I want you. He was singing that, and
she starts singing this perfect third, I think it is, over. You know, I don't know you, but I want you all the more. And that was lovely, and I just thought it sounded really great. You know, immediately it was like, wow, this is something, you know.
And I think I kind of went into what then became the chorus. I kind of, you know, started playing that chord progression, and I think Glenn sang that, take this sink in that vocal.
And then I, the second time, sang the higher one. So I went, because I think I was trying to say to her, like, maybe, what have you tried this one? But she said, it sounds better when you sing in it. So the fact that I'm singing the lead, and then in that moment I go into the harmony and she takes the lead, there was just something very unusual about it. And my first thought after writing it was, is it too romantic? I immediately kind of start questioning myself, going, is it too romantic? Because it's very romantic, it's very open, it's very bare. And I think up to that point, I'd been a little bit more guarded when I wrote songs. Again, remember, I was in a rock band with a bunch of guys who, when you sing certain words or if you allow yourself to open up in certain ways, it's kind of maybe considered a bit vulnerable, you know? Whereas for some reason, Mara Vulnerable seemed very natural.
Literally, when I started playing music with Mar, from Falling Slowly, that from that moment of singing that harmony and hitting this thing and everything becoming so easy and finishing the song and then going out for a walk the next day, and we wrote Lies the next afternoon on a walk. We just start writing the lyrics for this song. We came home, we sat down at the piano and we had Lies. So we had Lies and Falling Slowly, done. And then I remember Once came again, just came out of nowhere, and I was like, oh my God, things are so easy with this girl. Things are just happening.
Give me your hand, the dog in the garden road, covered in mud, dragging your mother's clothes, cinder and smoke, the snake in the bay.
Are you from Ireland too?
I'm Joe.
Are you from Ireland too?
Yeah.
And I met you earlier.
Simon.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, that's funny. What's your name?
I'm Ben.
Ben, you're not from Ireland.
Not
though.
Even.
Yes. Yeah. There's so many things pulling you on the road here. There's some days when you don't even know what day it is. You know, your days just run in. Monday runs into a Thursday, and a Thursday is a Tuesday. You know, and when you meet so many people and so many new faces in so many towns, it's hard to distinguish one from the other. So it's a big mind game, you know, that you have to put everything into perspective or it'll get away from you.
Thank you.
We had a pen earlier and we were just playing around and she told me to write something on her arm. So I wrote Marquetta on her arm. And then I wrote Glenn on my arm and we were pretending to be them.
No, we weren't pretending. We were just laughing about it.
Yeah.
Check out this poster, right?
Get out to the beach.
See this?
They made my legs longer.
And mine.
Right? They made my legs longer. I was wearing a hat, so they photoshopped my head. They put a different jacket on me. And they made us hold hands, which we don't do in the photograph.
And they got rid of the strap.
Those fucking bastards. They took my bag off my back and they gave me a green scarf. They completely fucked with it.
And that's the most offensive part, like...
They didn't change you at all, though.
They did. Did they?
No.
They didn't.
They obviously they made me more handsome.
They reddened up.
That's really depressing.
Yeah. Well, you got that one, didn't you?
Yeah.
Okay. Excelente. Good so, show time in about 15 minutes.
What?
What?
Really?
Yeah.
You're kidding me.
No, I'm not.
Try that.
It's
better now. Lock the hotel.
All your crutches.
Yeah.
You know, it's a funny thing that, that
these things only come around once in a lifetime. You could actually parachute Marquetta into any Frames album, and there'd be space there for her to do what she does, because she does what she does so effortlessly. And so naturally, do you know what I mean?
You have broken me all the way down, down upon my knees. And you have broken me all the way down. You be the last you see.
Give me $100 if he speaks at all. And, you know, have I seen my money?
Cold hard cash.
I have.
I've given you everything I've ever made.
No, that's...
Every cent you've taken out of me. I've looked up, I found Mar in Czech Brides, like when we first met. There's a magazine that I found Czech Brides, and I rang the number because, you know, you're lonely. You're in a hotel, you're on tour with the boys. Hello, my name is Marquetta. Hello, how's it going? You know, we hung out, you know, trying to make small talk to you. You know, I'm a musician. I play piano. Oh, cool. Every fucking penny I've ever made, she's fleeced me.
Easy written songs for you. He's even written songs.
I've written songs for you.
Yeah.
That's priceless.
Should I say happy birthday or just fine?
Beautiful, sweet, tender. Oh, and we did cry. We have some stuff going on.
Just, it was beautiful. I mean, it's God, it's got right in there. Way in. Heart. It did.
Yeah, you guys are a beautiful story, and hope you guys make it till the end of time.
And God bless you. You'll have a wonderful future.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Mm-hmm. You don't forget, Glenn, what happened to the man who suddenly got everything he always wanted.
Then I went home, and I had to graduate from high school. And so I got that done. And then I thought, you know, okay, I'm gonna now, you know, think about what I wanna do. And then I got swept in this wave of going on tour, and I thought it's gonna stop next month, and you know, okay, what I'm gonna do. It just wasn't stopping it.
Oh yeah.
Glenn, could I give you a hug?
Yes, of course.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. Absolutely loved it tonight.
Cheers. Thank you.
Love you.
Well, some guy today had a tattoo. He said, look at my tattoo. He had a tattoo which said, fair play to those who dare to dream. Was what it said on it, wasn't it?
Which is what I said.
Yeah. And he was like, look at my arm. And we were like, fucking hell. Fair play to those who dare to dream was written on his arm. And then I noticed on his other arm was all these autographs. Like, he'd obviously got people to sign his arm. I don't know who they were, and I didn't ask him. But he'd gotten people to sign his arm and tattooed it. And it was like, this whole arm was autographs. It was the weirdest thing. If it was like Nelson Mandela on his arm that he's got tattooed, then fair enough. Do you know what I mean? Or like, if it was people that are, like, who were genuinely huge. But if it was Joe Satriani, like...
They are Fred.
Do you know what I mean? And I think I come from that thing. Whenever me and you encounter people, I always come from that thing of, like, 17 years, you know, playing to, like, 40 people and going to myself... You know, every single person is like, how's it going?
No,
thank you. Thanks for coming. Fucking nice one.
You're walking up to the front of the stage and you're plugging it, or you're not plugging your guitar and you're singing a song, and it's absolutely completely still and quiet, and then it's rapturous applause, and I'm on the side of the stage seeing it going, wow. You know, before you've even played a note, the audience is with you.
Yeah. Right. Praise the Lord, it's a good life.
Cheers.
We're blessed.
Let go of my hand. You've already said it, so leave. Let go of my hand. You said what you came to now.
Tough as nails, you know, he knows exactly what he's doing because he's been doing it since he was 14 years of age. Marquette, on the other hand, has just been dropped into this thing where, you know, she steps off a tour bus in the blazing sun in Phoenix at 10 o'clock in the morning, having slept for 5 hours maybe, on a bumpy bus, and steps off the bus into the blinding sun, and there's two total strangers waiting with camera phones.
And you're just basically dealing with it for about a minute.
Oh, wow. I thought that you had the best speech at the Oscars. I was so happy that you got to come out and actually say something, and I just fool around with jewelry and other little things, and so I made that for you.
Wow.
Oh, that's very cool.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
It's
beautiful.
It's great to meet Oscar winners and film stars and musicians all in one. It's fabulous. So I hope we have a great show tonight. Okay.
Yeah, so do I.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay, if we take a picture.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thank you.
Actually,
guys, this looks like we're just gonna
cross through
for
ourselves.
We're
gonna
roll back to the venue.
I'm sorry.
I just don't
want to.
I think they always disperse.
There's like a million people.
Okay, cool.
We're
about to get
strong.
Alright,
here's just one.
Sorry.
On three, one.
Well, I hope you enjoy it.
Thank
you so much. No
ample there. Monitor combined.
I'll be at your door when there's no one worth running for. When your mind's made up, when your mind's made up, there's no point trying to change it. When your mind's made up, when your mind's made up.
We became so familiar with the struggle, and the struggle within struggle, you have, if it works out, it's great. If it doesn't work out, you tried. And now it's about expectation. And so within expectation, you have the sense that you have a chance of failure. And that is really, I think, what brings the darkness and something like Glenn, because he's never actually, the expectation of putting on a good show is one thing, but the expectation of the world looking at you and wondering what you're going to do next, that's something that's so new to all to us, and you can fail at that.
Top in the beginning, and then it just got really, really good. How'd you feel about it?
I think we did the best we possibly could under the circumstances.
Mm. I enjoyed it.
I just thought the first kind of 20 minutes was,
yeah,
it was tough work.
Mm. Me and John were going, so he's on fucking fire, isn't he? That's always the way, though.
You think if
it
the,
is, yeah,
the gig wasn't great,
it, yeah,
you think
yeah.
It hadn't been a great gig, and people come and go, Jesus, that was amazing, and
yeah.
If the gig isn't going my way, you get a bit angry, you know? And the anger just comes out like you just sort of dig into it really, really hard, and people go, Jesus Christ, you were tearing the stage apart up there, you know? When you get angry sometimes. I think anger works for me and it works for you, you know? Sometimes our anger works for Christy Moore too, you know?
Does Christy get angry?
Oh, Jesus, very angry, yeah. Very angry.
First of being it so hard on yourself,
then. It's just a middle of the tour blues.
Him he'd have revenge, so he stood and wait be James's gate till the poor owl bag came up, and with his twang knife sure he took the life and the poor owl gathered him up.
We sailed away from Derry on the 23rd of May. We were boarded by a pleasant crew, all bound for America. Fresh water there we did take on, 5,000 gallons or more. In case we'd run short, going to New York, far away from the Shamrock Shore.
Woo! Eagle has landed.
In the country where we're headed, love, there's nothing but rocks and stone. No friendly plant or animal, no angel to guide you home. Well, the long grass has grown, the wild birds flown to their homes, away in the blue, and now nothing is the same. The whole world has changed since you and I were true.
When I spent $3,000 on the CD, if you, I knew there was something there. I wouldn't have asked the bank manager for $3,000. Oh, I did. I got 3,000 of him. I won't tell you what I told him. Maybe he said, if he, "What happens if you're not able to pay?"
You already did just now.
Oh, no, I didn't. No, that could be Anton. No, I didn't say it. There was nothing wrong, nothing bad. No, it was nothing bad, in case he's thinking nothing bad now.
Well, you better tell them then.
No. Ah, no, it was nothing bad.
My mother's joke was, she would always say to us, find them, feel them, fuck them, forget them. That was my mother's. She would always say that to us when we were kids, you know. And she was like, and which I thought was very funny, you know. She would always say, never marry, don't ever turn into this guy. See, and she would point at him because he'd be on the couch drunk, you know, asleep. Say, look at that. You fucking turn into that and I will fucking disown you.
He put his hand into the frying pan. Right? Silly, full of drink.
I was a good cuke. That was fucking terrible.
Oh, God help him. He was frying the fish.
Frying
the fish. And the fish, you know, the wee fish splashes. And all here and all there.
It just seems that it's like as if Greece loves me.
The hospital thinks that I'm deliberately wrong.
Fairy tale.
Took 3 weeks to heal it.
Can come true.
It can happen to you.
It can happen to you.
When you're young at heart.
My dad was the All-Ireland champ four times in a row.
He was a boxer for 11 years and he never lost a fight in 11 years.
He had a great career ahead of him. He was invited to America to go boxing.
They actually came and asked him to go to America. And he gave us a beautiful house. Where was that?
Met my mother and she got pregnant. She was 16 and he was, 17? Then we'd all sit around the living room, brassoing my dad's trophies.
Silvo and all of them.
And then we'd have them all gorgeous and we'd put them up and then next Sunday, out with the brass.
Played with him and his bro.
Why aren't they out in front of all of
them? They were all
battered.
Yeah. See that? I'm fucking sick telling her that. Look at you, I see you, I'm sick of fucking you.
I know.
I'm sick of you and her, actually.
You know, my dad, I think, kind of let go of his dream at that point, you know? And then began drinking.
Were you afraid?
I was fucking hugely confident in the game, at the boxing game.
But what were you afraid of?
I was lost.
Why did chap ask you why you just turn it down? Why did you?
I was lost every other way. I hadn't got the confidence any other way. But in the boxing, it's fucking definitely fucking
you. He says you done the farm.
Ah, yeah.
He said, I lost me vocation in life with Glenn.
I said, I knew what I could do. And I knew I could fucking bait them all. But one thing I will say, I said, when I seen him winning the Oscar, I said, fuck it, he done it for me. True.
And you could have took the world.
I said, I could have took the world myself, but he done it for me.
Whatever me dad was going through, he just didn't want to impose on us, you know? And I think he made the decision as a young man to just bury something. I think he just made the decision to bury something. And whatever that was, even though it was never spoke about, it was never brought up in the home, whatever it was, we fucking felt it. And in a way, I kind of felt like I had to be the one to carry that all the way.
Like a buzzing fly, I'll come into your life and I'll float away like honey in the sun now. I wasn't right or wrong, I couldn't sing that song now anyway. Shone down now, and how it warmed your pretty smile when all the love was there. You know what I talk about, you know what I think about, everywhere I go now. I'll be dialing now in the morning how I miss you so. How I miss you so. How I miss you so. Not where I promised you we'd be by now.
said, we're not where I promised you we'd be by now. But maybe if we leave it, even now the rainbow's end seems closer to your hand. And is it knowing when to stop the measure of the man?
Seems quite prophetic, that song, isn't it? Weirdly. The funny thing happens to you when you when you sing a song is that you sometimes it you find yourself singing about stuff that's like gonna happen or something. It's weird. You're like singing songs about breakups in a perfectly happy relationship, and then you know, I mean, that's a, quite a common one, but like the idea that and then it happens pretty much exactly as you sang it. Even though when you sang it, you were like, this is not about me. You know what I mean? This doesn't feel like it's about my life or whatever. I don't have much of a voice left on me after last night. Drinking, you know?
Yeah, but it's not fair, because you knew that when you drank, you were going to have a weak voice today, but I didn't do anything like that.
Mm. Come on.
How are you? That's Kira.
Wait, why am I still?
She's gonna come off.
That's cool to do, except the electricity is off, and it's just like there. Tom Billy's it.
Yeah,
I don't know, lads. I just can't. Like every time I do the picture thing, I just don't know if I can justify it anymore. I seriously don't. I know that
you're definitely
like,
the wrong job.
But like, you're all like, you know, take like make fun of it and everything. But I'm serious. Like
I know you're right.
I don't.
Know
but
no,
it's not,
nobody here doesn't take you serious.
But it's not some kind of a rock star bullshit. I just I don't know why people do it. I don't understand it, and I don't like supporting you because I. You know, I feel like I'm just prostituting myself because I don't believe in it. And yet, I am doing it. But what is the way out of that, Howard?
It's not, you don't have to.
No, you walk out the front door.
Go out the other door, You know, it's not something that just because you go and play music and people like you that you're kind of, you know, it's mandatory that you have to go out the back door and sign fucking loads of autographs.
You just don't put yourself in those situations.
You see, then I'm just, like, offending people because I'm ignoring them, you know? And I don't want to be ignoring them. I just want to somehow.
I'm gonna go visit the people. I'll see you later. I think that'll be a minority, though. I think that'll be the minority of the time. I think you can.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I know.
This is a
pretty
good stuff, isn't it?
I'm just so bored of that conversation.
I'm gonna want you to make her drink.
So I just wanted
to find so strong to have you here.
So,
she asked for you.
See you later, yeah?
I can totally understand it being difficult for Mar. You know, whatever, 19 years of age. you know, over the last 2 years, her world has just flipped.
You guys out here?
No. See you later, yeah?
Oh, okay, with you. Okay.
Well, there's people out there, you know what I
mean? It's pretty gone.
But what I think upsets Glenn is that Mara is so uncomfortable with it, and uncomfortable to the point of tears on occasions.
Have a good time, man.
I wouldn't sit saying to Marquetta, it'll be all right, it'll be different tomorrow. I just tell her, look, it's not going to get any better. You know, you've got to want to do this.
Thank you very much, man. Appreciate it very much.
Hey, dude.
We're
going to
make it.
Oh, absolutely.
I just said to them, look, I'll sign everything that you want me to, and, you know, and I'm absolutely happy to see you, and how are you, but let's not do the whole picture thing, because that's celebrity bullshit, and I'm not a celebrity. And they totally got it. It's like they totally understood, and to a certain extent, maybe they appreciated, you know, that that's maybe not expected of them, or that you know, and I had a great time with them, and I was able to hang out and actually enjoy it, as opposed to, like, doing something that was totally against my own instincts and cringing and, you know, resisting it the whole way through.
You know, I know, we all know it's gonna be fine.
It is, it's gonna be fine, but it's like, why? Surely there's some kind of a standard that you have, and you shouldn't ever go below it, unless you have to.
Well, we have to.
No, we don't have to. We can just not say, look, you didn't get the piano that we want, and I'm not gonna play.
Back when?
Yeah, the stone will last really long, you know.
Twisting.
Look garlic.
I do not, babe. Come on, it's you. Yeah? We're gonna be good, aren't we?
Your miserable will fall apart. Yeah?
Mar?
Mark's still on.
Glenn, you, there's no break in between the gigs. You're supposed to be ready with the guitar. I'm not your TM, man.
Well, you're supposed to stop acting like it.
Well, my class put you on the pressure because you got all stressed out.
I said you should.
She's totally stressing me, telling me to come on. I don't want to disturb Mark's gig. I'm here.
No, sure, you stop. Wait here. Yeah, I just didn't want to. Or wait there, yeah?
Yeah.
All I said was be ready. My dad, yeah. The thing that is stressful is your mama made the
call. It's your job, not hers. Now we're fighting.
Glenn, I needed you on the terrace.
I could hear Mark from my room.
Yeah, but I can't be at the same time on the two places.
No.
Listening with Mark having encore.
But Mark's getting fucking freaked out, coming up and giving out to me, and there's no reason to.
Yeah, maybe Mark will not make an encore. Maybe people won't clap. Yeah, so you have to be prepared.
But I was ready.
But I didn't see
you. Now.
You weren't ready, Glenn. I had to go up and get you twice. If I didn't go up and get you, you would still be there.
I was thinking to myself, if you hadn't come up to me the first time and given out to me, I would have actually had my jacket changed.
Yeah, right.
Well, the city's got the charm of a painted lady, and survival bites you like a black-headed bitch. You find yourself on the closest corner. You wanna stay, you wanna go. You got the fork town itch. Got the fork town itch. You know that feeling of just coming up? That panic, that fucking white, terrifying panic. It's constant at the moment, it's weird. And I get it together and everything's fine and then it just comes again. It's anxiousness, this kind of feeling. Just, okay, I'll go get the sheets off the bed and I'll wash them. Okay, I'll do that in a minute, okay. And I'd stand there for a while. And then I put on the kettle. And then I'd go and I'd into the bedroom to take the sheets off, and then I'd come back in and I'd put the kettle back on again because it would have gone off by itself. And I'm close, man. I'm fucking close to being in a really dark, weird place, you know.
Tell you one thing, there's not many around our neighbourhood can say that they have a son that won an Oscar. In fact, none of them, and probably never will. You have no idea what that meant to the people in my neighbourhood.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I'm listening to that every single day. I listen to it.
My mother is kind of close to me. And when I tell her how I honestly feel, she's baffled. She's just baffled.
I mean, it's like we talked to you the night about, you were saying when we were in the newspaper, and you were talking about how great it was, and I was trying to explain how I don't enjoy it and how I don't like it. And we ended up getting into that same argument about the attention. You're like, Claire rang. You rang Claire a few weeks ago saying, Glenn should be in the newspaper every day. And Claire's on the other phone, on the end of the phone, Claire is going, but Glenn doesn't want to be in the newspaper every day. And you're like, but he should be.
Yeah, well, maybe, again, as I said, we come from two different, we're coming from two different lanes. If I had my way, you'd be in the paper every day, good, bad, or indifferent. I'd have you out there creating problems just to get you in the paper.
Jesus.
And you're the opposite. You see, people forget very quick, you know, and you can be a 7-day wonder and then all of a sudden you disappear. I mean, my great-great-great-great-grandchildren won't know who I was, but they will know who you are.
And that's good.
You were this guy who won this Oscar.
And that's good. Because that's the question I'm struggling with. Who cares?
Well, we all care here. We love it.
No, but what's so important about being remembered 7 generations down? It's just a human instinct.
Come here, I tell you, don't start taking me thing away from me. Please leave me with this. You know what I mean? Don't start. I don't want to be going around saying, who cares? Yeah, he's right.
No, I don't mean who cares. I just mean, I'm just going to shut up.
No, because now you have me going saying, yeah, he's right, fuck it. And maybe I'll just let it go. I'll put it in the press and hide it away from everybody. No, don't take that away from me. You think what way you like. Leave me here thinking the way I think.
Yeah, absolutely. I wouldn't want you to think the way I do. Certainly. I really enjoyed myself last night. And it's the first time I've enjoyed myself. Kind of relaxed and just enjoyed myself. In a while. The last time I was with my mother. She was basically saying, you know, the award defines you.
The award defines you?
Yeah, it defines you. And I was making the point, it doesn't define anyone. And so we ended up getting into it. My ma was kind of like that. And my ma said something lovely. She said, leave me with this, will you? Let me have this, will you? And it was lovely, because it made me realize that she's just proud of me. And she's into it. And she just said, let me have this, will you? I left very depressed, because I realized I'd hurt my mother's feelings, you know? By my own fucking, you know, whining.
You've just replaced your struggles with different struggles. But you're still struggling, and you always find something to struggle with. And it's just such a hard existence, is it not? To always find a battle. Like, why can't you just... I don't know, it's like... You wanted this. You can't say you didn't want it. And now you're rejecting it. I just find the idea of living my life with a constant sense of struggle really exhausting. I can't imagine living my life that way. You know, it's, and I just wonder, how do you do it? Because you are constantly struggling, aren't you?
No.
You are. You've just said it. It's so rare for me. I haven't hung out, being able to just hang out like that and just be happy in ages.
I meant, like, in the past few months.
Yeah? I don't know. I just don't get it. I'm sorry. I don't, you know, that's... I don't mean to judge you or criticize you. It's your thing. I'm just saying, would you not just, you know, stop struggling all the time? So?
You're a great support, Mar.
Well, what do you want me to say? Like, you know, yeah, Glenn, you know, your life is shit. You know, you're right to be struggling. Here, have another point and... You know, let's drink to that sadness or that struggle. No, it's that's bullshit. Is it not?
I think what you're saying is bullshit.
Meaning?
Meaning, like, what's your point?
My point is that by saying all this, it doesn't mean that I'm not supportive. It means that I'm being your mate and I'm going, come on, it's all good.
Okay, so the next time you're moaning and struggling with something, I'll come with this attitude to you and see how we get on, yeah?
It's not about that. It's not like... It's not like I'm like this all the time. It's just that when... okay, I'll just shut up, yeah?
Yeah. I need that of your fighting.
Want more coffee or something?
Well, I'm okay. Thanks, man.
How did you pick these?
Why are you getting annoyed? I'm on your side.
I know you are. You make me sound like a fucking manic depressive. I was coming into this conversation from the point of view of I've learned something. I didn't need you to give me a hard time about it.
I'm not trying to give you a hard time, Glenn. I'm trying to be your friend. Can you not see that?
I just want to go on a holiday.
Kids.
Would you be into going somewhere like?
Be here.
Nepal or somewhere really proper foreign. That's what I'd like to do.
Okay.
You?
Come on. I'm gonna go, yeah? See you later, yeah? Dan? You have to stop.
Thank you. On Raglan Road, of an autumn day, I saw her first and knew that her dark hair would weave a snare that I might one day. I saw the danger and I passed along the enchanted way. And I said, let grief be a fallen leaf at the dawning of the day.
My dad drank himself to death. Before he died, we were in the kitchen one night and he started talking a bit. And he was drunk, of course, as usual. And I said to him, I said, Dad, because I guess I was the one in the family that did speak to him the most, apart from my mother, of course. But I said to him, Dad, listen, is there going to be a revelation? Is there going to be some, are you going to sit us down one day and tell us something heavy? Because it really, I'm on tour so much of the time and I want to know if you're going to sit us down and tell us. Because, you know, because at this stage it was clear he was dying and he knew and we knew and it, like there was no, the doctors hadn't hidden anything from him. And he said, son, I'll tell you this now. All you are sitting here now, I'll tell you this. I'm going to stay drunk until I go. You won't hear anything from me. There'll be no big sit down, there'll be no big talk. I love yous all, but I don't want, there's things inside me I don't want any of you to ever know anything about. And that was his big speech to us, you know? And it made me, and at the time I thought, gosh, I wish he would just go talk to someone, or I wish whatever was going on in his life, I wish he'd just say, you know, because nothing can be that bad that you completely give up. But he did stay drunk, fair play to him, you know, he's a man of his word, he did stay drunk and he did die. And so all we have is that one line, you know, there's things in me that I don't want you guys ever to see or know anything about. And he left and he was gone. And I fucking admire him for it.
This is kind of a song about the fact that sometimes people grow apart from each other because they grow at a different pace or in a different way, and or because it just, the timing wasn't right, or, you know, the circumstances weren't right, and you come into an understanding that that there is a love you share that is bigger than all those things, and it's not necessarily going to work out in this lifetime, but maybe in the next one. Because the connection is strong enough that when you are born the next time, you will find that person again, wherever that person is in the world. So it's about that.
Forgive me, lover, for I have sinned, for You know, for a long time, it was me adopting Glenn's ideas of the world and, you know, opinions on things. And then at one point, I just kind of started going a little bit more my own way. And like one thing was to kind of, you know, disagreeing maybe on some things or forming a different opinion or just kind of feeling, you know, I need to find my own way on this. I don't want to just kind of accept this, your way of looking at things or your way of doing things. I want to find my own way through this. And I want to be allowed to find my own way through things, you know. I want that to be okay.
You know, myself and Mara sleep across from each other in the bus. You know, she's in that bunk, I'm in this bunk. So, you know, I guess we're still very close, but that relationship ended. And that's that, you know. It's I don't think, you know, I think you have to, I've had to let go of it, she's had to let go of it. It is what it is, and it's, you know, it actually is a lot, we're just a lot closer.
For as long as the heavens permit, I may not know you. Yeah. Yeah, I like the shirts on you.
Yeah.
For as long as the heavens exist, there will be distance.
That one.
That we'll both have to come to expect. You gonna wear your hat?
No, you're rocking.
And the wild envy of our dark and feathered friends. Scratching at the surface now, and I'm trying hard to work it out. And so much has gone misunderstood, and this mystery only leads to doubt. And I didn't understand. Down and take my hand, and if you have something to say, you better say it now, 'cause this is what you're praying.
do the recording now?
1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. This diamond's growing in the mountains beneath the pressure of all time. That growing hope and expectation, waiting for your hands to find, 'cause only you could reach inside me and figure out the worth of a life I lived, providing what it was you needed most. Fantasy man, you are always one step ahead of me. Well, I never on now, you are for